So, if you are joining me for the first time, hi, my name is Jala, and I am currently streaming Lone Wolf Remastered, Joe Devers Lone Wolf Remastered, based on the book series by the same name that are basically choose-your-own-adventure books, but with math. And last time I streamed, I did the first section of the first chapter, so we are going to continue on with the story from here. I love the music in this game, so the audio I will leave at the level it's at right now. As long as you can hear me and you can also hear the music, that is what I'd like. This game is mostly text-based with some action scenes, so you will have lots of me reading. We are in Act 1, Chapter 2. Blood on the Snow 2. Leandra prepares for the mission. She gathers up some food and some tools, and she puts them in her backpack. As she is fastening the flap, she says something which surprises you. When I saw you for the first time, I thought you were a grown man. But now, you seem really young to me. Leandra shoulders her backpack. Then she picks up a stiletto dagger and slips it inside her belt. There's an old tunnel in the cellar of this house, she says, and it runs all the way to the foundry. My father and I often use it to go there and buy the Bronin and iron we need for our inventions. You can use it as well to reach the foundry without having to take your chances out in the open. Or you can come with me and I'll show you where the sheriff's office is. The foundry on your own, or the sheriff's office with Leandra. The choice is yours. Okay. Well, let's go ahead and go to the sheriff's office with Leandra. That sounds like a good endeavor to me. Your crossbow is nearly empty, and when it is, all you'll have left are your wits and a dagger to use against the Geox. No, I cannot let you risk that. Let you that risk alone. Ah! I was auto-correcting to an actual sentence, but it messed up in the text in the actual thing. Okay, anyway, no, I cannot let you face that risk alone. I'm just gonna fix it, you say, with a forceful tone. Leandra starts to protest, but you cut her off in the middle of her first sentence. We shall leave together, and that's the end of it. As soon as you can show me where the sheriff's office is, we shall split up. I will look for Tarler. You will go to the boiler house. Is that clear? Perfectly clear, she says, with more than a trace of resentment. Because, yeah, like, you just show up and you are bossing this chick around, like, as if, you know, as if you might be their liege lord. Ugh. You draw your weapon and move to the door. Leandra stays by the window and scours the streets for signs of Geox. It looks deserted, she says. Very well. Follow me and stay close, you reply. You pull open the front door and pause to make sure that Leandra is with you. She is standing in the doorway, her face frozen and expressionless. Then you hear noises that make your heart skip a beat. Geox are emerging from the shadows of the neighboring houses, and they are fast closing in on all sides. Where's the sheriff's office, you shout, demanding Leandra tell you before a fight ensues. She points along the main street toward the end of the village at the cliff's edge. On the left, 100 yards or so. This is all she can say before the first of the Geox comes running at you, with their weapon held ready to strike blows to your head and chest. Run, you shout, and Leandra is suddenly galvanized into action. She sprints away across the streets as the Geox surround you and press home their surprise attack. Great, following Leandra was not the way to go. Oh well. Fight it is. Thanks, Leandra. Let's even these odds and then shoot. Shoot! You didn't even let me dodge. Because they get a surprise attack. Damn it! Okay, let's call my little buddy. Yahoo! Get him! Oh no. I didn't even get a chance to... Oh shoot. No! I did not even spring up. Damn it. It's all twitchy. I forget. Oh god! Now there's another one. Great. Okay. That's it. At least my wolf's doing better than I am. Okay, come on. It's time. Oh, I don't have enough magic. Fuck that! Okay, never mind. Oh shoot! No! No! I'm gonna die! Holy crap! Okay. Alright. Go get him, Wolfie! He's gonna kill that one Giok all on his own. Good. I finally got one. Okay. Oh good. That guy died. No big deal. No. And you bled me. Great. Ah. No, Wolfie! What are you doing? The fight's not over! Damn it! Oh, okay. I cannot even use him again. Okay. Ooh. Let's use that. Right, 6 cents sounds like a good plan. Oh shoot. Oh, I have no stamina. I can't even block. You can see the blood squirting too. No! Ouch! Fuck nuts! You will bleed just like me. I have no Kai powers. I have no nothing. Damn it all. Oh, but I got my stamina back. Cool. Alright. Oh my god, it's not dead yet. Come on. Oh good, there it goes. You get magic back after doing that? That's... if I only knew, I would have done that sooner. Okay, I almost died, but I lived. I'd use one of my potions. Damn it. Take everything. Okay, you approach the door of the sheriff's office and take note of a painted shield that is fixed to the wall. It bears the distinctive emblem of Rockstar. Three crossed sledgehammers on a white crossed field. Beneath a slate-roofed porch, the main door is held ajar by a booted foot. It belongs to the body of a dead man, lying just inside the entrance. The stripes sewn onto the sleeves of his high-collared jacket tell you that this is Sheriff Taylor Tarler. He has been stabbed fatally in the back by a sharp Geox sword. You push open the door and step carefully inside the dead man's office. A search of his pockets reveals nothing. They have already been emptied. You sense that his personal items have been taken by the same Geox that took his life. You drag Tarler's body away from the entrance and push the door shut. The front room of the office is where the sheriff used to deal with daily matters of law and order in Rockstarn. Now those days are sadly gone. The room is dominated by a large desk made of sumlending oak, beautifully engraved with provincial emblems and the personal crests of sumlending heroes, past and present. In a corner of the room, you can see a large wooden chest with iron fittings, and at the back of the room, opposite the main door, there is a flight of broad stone steps that lead down to the jail cells below. This is where prisoners are held before a trial. So, I can attempt to pick the lock, or investigate the let's investigate the desk. You stand beside the oak desk and pick up one of several scrolls that are heaped upon the table's green leather surface. You unfurl it and begin to read the contents. It is a death warrant for a man called Merak Jalad, a thief who had been found guilty of murdering two of the sheriff's reeves, his deputies, who had chased Gilad and his accomplices to their hideout in the sunken forest. You read that Gilad pleaded innocent when accused of the crime. He claimed that the Reeves were murdered, but not by him, by Geox. At the bottom of the scroll, there is written, in Sheriff Tarler's hand, the date of Gilad's execution. It is today's date. So, how does Lone Wolf know that this is Sheriff Tarler's hand? Because Sheriff Tarler's dead. Oh well, that's not the point. I can make a choice. I can check the lower floor of the building or pick the lock. Let's try picking the lock. I don't know what lock I'm picking, but whatever it is, it must be important. And maybe there's a healing potion. Freak nuts. Let's try it again. I'm not gonna be able to do this, am I? I'm not gonna have any lockpicks left to do this. Got it! Yes! Managed to open the chest, it seems that the sheriff had made provision to withstand an attack by sheltering inside his office. However, when he was compelled to organize resistance to the attack, he left the office with fatal consequences. Clearly, these supplies will be of no use to him any longer. Oh yes, it is a healing item! Yes! Take everything. Ah, what? Oh shoot. Oh boy, okay. Oh, okay. Well, what is this? Timber, leather, crossbow bolts. Let's throw those away. Can I? Yes. Maybe that'll work. I still don't have enough room. Okay. About that. We will do that. Inventory management, it's the most exciting. Got four open spots. I need five open spots. Okay. Yeah. I guess I'll just eat this other breads. Oh, I don't need that right now. I don't want to waste it. Damn it. I don't want to get rid of those either. Ah, damn it. Okay, I guess I'll just go ahead and eat it. I want the other items. What? I can't use it? Oh, I guess because my Kai power is fully healed. Freak nut. Okay. Okay. See if I can equip. Is this new weapon better than the other weapon? +2 strength. Yeah, it's better. Okay. I want to sell that one. Rats. Oh, what a fuss. I totally need to keep that. Oh, I guess I'm gonna have to get rid of these. No, let's get rid of this. I don't want to get rid of it. No. Oh well. Okay. You descend the steps and arrive at a guard room, roughly hewn from the granite bedrock. It is lit by an oily torch that radiates dull amber light. It is sparsely furnished with a table, two chairs, and a food cupboard. There are two cells adjoining the guard room. One of them is empty, but the other is occupied by a tall man with long beard and strong calloused hands. His name has been chalked on a board fixed to the door of his cell, Marat Galad. Galad has gone without food and water since the morning of the Giyak attack. He has heard the screams and the sounds of crackling fire in the night, and he is anxious to escape from the cell before the Giyaks find him or he dies of thirst. Unlock the door, he demands. Release me from this cell. I want nothing to do with this village and its fine, upright, law-abiding inhabitants, and I certainly don't want anything to do with the Giyaks. And what if I were to open the cell and set you free? What would you do? Where would you go? The Giyaks are everywhere. You would be better off staying where you are. I'd go back to the sunken forest. That's my home, mine and my brother's. I've had more than enough of Rockstarn. You reply, your voice tinged with regret. The Giyaks launched their attack upon Rockstarn from the sunken forest. That timberland is rife with them. I pity the plight of your kinsfolk, but I fear it is too late for you to warn or save them now. You turn away from the cell door, and Galad shouts out, "The key is over there! Unlock this damn door!" He points toward an iron fitting that fixes the torch to the wall. It's hanging from the torch bracket. Gather more information, or... Yeah, let's gather more information. You want to know more about this prisoner before you decide his fate. Why have you been put into this cell, you ask? There must be some reason why you've been locked up. Is that not so? The lad's throat is parched with thirst. He says he will tell you everything, but he must have some water. He points to the large cupboard standing against the wall opposite his cell. You pull open the cupboard and find a pewter pitcher of water, an enameled iron cup, and half a loaf of stale bread. Answer me first, and answer me truthfully. Then I shall decide if you deserve this bread and water, and your freedom. He tells you his name is Murak Jalad. His brothers are not blood related. They are a band of robbers cast out of Tehran 3 years ago for burglary and street crimes. They found refuge in the sunken forest, and have survived there since, living off the plentiful flora and fauna. Not too long ago, he and his fellow thieves, his brotherhood as he calls them, used the elevator to enter Rockstarn. They had come looking to steal some Bronan arrowheads for hunting. Unfortunately, the sheriff and his reeves caught them in the act. They ran back, desperate to escape, but the sheriff apprehended him before he could get away. His brothers were more fortunate. They made good their escape and returned to their lair in the sunken forest. The reeves were killed during the chase, and he was blamed for their deaths. He tells you that he and his brothers are innocent. The reeves were killed by Geox. You are mindful of the fact that if you leave him locked in his cell, it will be only a matter of time before the Geox find him or he dies of thirst. If you release him, he will at least have half a chance to survive. It may be a slim chance, but it's better than no chance at all. Alright. You open the cell, or uphold the law. Well. Let us open the cell. You walk over to the torch and unhook the key from its black iron bracket. Jalad looks relieved that you have decided to set him free. You twist the key in the lock, and the heavy door creaks open. Jalad rushes forward and shakes your hand in gratitude, but with such forceful enthusiasm that you have to push him away for fear he may break your wrist. That is some pretty strong enthusiasm, is it not? He reaches into the pocket of his jacket, and for a moment you suspect he may have a concealed weapon, but you quickly sense that he harbors no ill intent. He simply wants to give you a token of his gratitude. It is a plain wooden ring, carved from some lending oak. It's the mark of my brotherhood. It's not much, but it's all I have. You accept the ring from his calloused palm, and step aside to let him leave this dingy cell. Jalad rushes through the open door and scrambles up the stone stairs. You bid him good luck as he disappears into the room above. So, I need to take it, but now I got another... Oh, I actually have a spot for it. Cool. Oh, it doesn't take up a slot. It actually just goes onto my finger. And it's got +2 dex. Yes. Okay. You return to the street, saddened by the death of Sheriff Tarler, and disappointed that you have not found the control handle. You fear that the Geox now possess this missing part. As you move along the street, you are lost in your thoughts of how difficult it will be to find the control handle. It could be anywhere in this village. Distracted, you fail to see a gang of Geox approach from a nearby alleyway. Yay. There is me with all the Geox. Perfect. Ekdok, get him, they cry, and they come rushing forward towards you with their weapons drawn. I'm glad I ate that stuff so I can be all healed before fighting them. Great. Let's summon my buddy! Woo! Get him! Ew, you suck. Alright. That's cool. Let's do do this. Cause a lot of damage. Oh, shoot! Screw you and your block. I have no more anything. Oh no! Alright, I'm a heal. Yoinks. Die already, guy! Man! Oh, I missed it. Rats! I missed one! At least I got one of them dead. One of them's dead. I'm sucking at the combat right now. Okay. Hey, that's not cool. I'm dizzied. Get him, wolf! The wolf is the only one that can fight today. Oh, he's running away. Not cool. He's like, okay, I'm done. Peace out. Oh, my life. Literally, my life. Oh, that's good. Let's do health regeneration. Alright. Let's do this again. Oh, fuck. Damn it. Oh. That was barren. I just burned all my healing items again.
Duh.
I totally need another Kai pouch. Let me look at my inventory real quick, make sure it automatically puts it where it needs to be. Where is my inventories? Ah. Oh, it does have a Kai pouch there. Cool. Alright, good. It just yet. If I am in a very dire situation, I will. Okay. You have dispatched these Geoks, but the threat of an attack and capture is as strong as ever. You can hear other Geoks approaching this part of the village, drawn by the noise of your combat. You look around for some place to hide, and your eye is caught by a small building with a bright red door and a sloping slate roof. Cool. Well, let's move over there first, because I cannot heal here. Yes. The red door is closed, but it is not locked. You enter and quickly shut the door behind you. It is a simple village doctor's office, and it appears to not have been searched and despoiled like so many other buildings in this part of Rockstar. At the rear of the office, partitioned by a drawn white curtain, you find the surgery where a man is lying on a stretcher. His legs are wrapped with blood-soaked bandages, and he is barely conscious. Sweat glistens on his pale face. He sees you, and, falteringly, he tries to talk. You tell the man to rest. He has lost a lot of blood, and his strength is waning. But he is determined to speak. He knows they may well be the last words he ever utters. My name is Grove. I am a Rockstar miner. My legs were crushed by a runaway mine wagon. They brought me here. They bandaged me, and that's when the Geox attacked. Dr. Paxnar left to get help. I cannot walk, and he could not carry me. So here I am. You ask the man if he knows where the doctor went. He said he was going to the Bronin warehouse. There were some people there who would help. He promised he would come back for me, but I have not seen him since. I fear the Geox must have gotten him. So, I didn't master the discipline of healing. I could try to help him using the medications in the surgery, or I hide him. Well, let's see if we can help him. Grove's bandages are saturated with blood, and you can detect the faint and sickly smell of gangrene. Carefully, you unwind the sodden bandages and cast them aside. Both calf bones have been shattered and the flesh is torn open. You clean his wounds with sterile water from the surgery store cupboard, and you dress them with lomstor leaves and fresh bandages. Your timely and caring action may well save Grove's life. Soothed by the lomstor, his body relaxes and he falls into a deep sleep. There is little more you can do for him now. Reluctantly, you leave Grove and return to the Red Door. You must complete your mission, and you are sorely aware that time is running out. You leave the doctor's surgery and continue along the street, but you have taken fewer than a dozen steps before you are confronted by a new threat. A solitary Geox is approaching the main street from a passageway next to the surgery. Its hateful eyes dart everywhere, searching out something to steal or someone to kill. This sharp-eyed Geox may have seen you leaving. It could tempt it to find out what lies beyond the Red Door. You cannot risk Grove's survival by allowing this watchful Geox to live a minute longer. So here we go. Fight. Hi there, how are you doing? You're catching me at a fight scene. I have sucked at these so far today. I've not been very dexterous. Alright. Let us... all of my everything. Let's call my Wolfie. I think my wolf will take him out for me. I won't even really need to do anything, so it's okay. Almost! Of course he has to get a pot shot in. Damn it. I'm almost dead. How exciting. Alright. Yahoo! That's a new battle stance. Usually he just walks away. I was gonna die the next time I have a fight. Alright. Yay, more stuff. Take everything. You hurry away and continue along the street, keeping to the shadows whenever you can. A sign on the wall indicates the direction of the Bronin warehouse. Helped by the sign, you look along the street and see the warehouse in the middle distance. It is one of the largest two-story buildings in Rockstarn, and is easy to find now that you know precisely where it is. That's a funny sentence. Alright. Yeah, sure, it's real easy to see now. Okay, let us heal, because I fucking need it. Okay. Yeah, I know, there's dangers, but look at my life! Please heal fully. Oh yes! Okay. You can be interrupted when you are in the middle of resting. Whew! Okay. Twenty crows are sitting in a line upon the apex of its great gray slate roof. Their black eyes watch you intently as you draw closer. The great double doors at the front of the warehouse are shut, and all of the building's windows have been smashed. There are heaps of splintered timbers, broken crates, overturned handcarts used for transporting Bronan ingots, and myriad other debris scattered around its entrance. The evidence of a Geok devastation is plain for all to see. You stop for a few moments, using the cover of a shadowy doorway to view the warehouse and decide the best way to try and enter this building. Oh, I've got all kinds of approaches. I can use mining carts as a battering ram. Push the mining cart inside the warehouse as a diversion. Enter the building and thin out the Geok line with mine blast attacks. Or, thanks to animal kinship skills, I am able to ask the crows on the rooftop for help. I am all about this animal kinship. Let me get with my birdie buddies. Come on, crows. You stop to return the morbid stares of the crows. These canny and patient birds learned centuries ago to identify and follow raiding parties such as the Geox that have attacked Rockstarn. They would wait for their grisly work to end, and then take their chance to feast upon the fallen at their leisure. However, their appetite is rarely sated, and gratitude is a sentiment that is simply not in their nature. As repugnant as they may be, you know that they could be useful allies. You can direct them to attack the Geox that provided such a gruesome banquet. You identify the leader of this murder of crows. Drawing upon your Kai power of animal kinship, you plant a suggestion in its feral mind. The crow blinks twice. It is a sign that it will be obedient to your commands. How do you know? Blink twice is... okay, whatever. You will the crow leader to take to the air, and it responds immediately. It leaves its perch atop the warehouse roof, and the rest of the flock follows swiftly in its wake. They circle the rooftop, calling plaintively. Upon your mental command, they dive down in single file and enter the warehouse through a ragged hole in the gray slate tiles. For a few seconds, there is an eerie silence. Then the screaming begins. The crows launch a surprise attack on the Geox inside the warehouse, swooping down on them to gouge out their eyes and slash their faces with their curved beaks and razor-sharp talons. You seize the chance to enter the building while the Geox are distracted. You climb through an open window and witness the bloody aftermath of the attack. When the wounded Geox see you standing in their midst, they raise their weapons and close in on you from all sides. Perfect! I just jumped literally in the middle of them. Now what the hell is this? There is an imposing Drakkar among them. Oh, hell. And it is he who gives the ruthless order to kill you. Oh, fuck nuts. We got a leveled up monster, guys. Oh, my life. Yay. Alright. I think it may be best to... use my super big power! Good. Chop his ass down a little bit. Okay. Oh hell, I can't use anything else. Okay. Oh, no, let's bleed him. All right. Let's bleed everybody. Bleed for me. All right. Oh, fuck, I missed one of them. Ah. Okay. Damn it. Oh well. Ew, that hurt. That's okay. Ooh, ooh. Okay, that's not cool. Great. Screw you, hippie. Yay! Kill him! Alright, awesome. Awesome, cool, I'm taking him down. Yay! Oh, he's all messed up anyway. Oh well, that's okay. It will recharge my stamina. Other than having to burn another healing item, that was actually pretty good. Alright. Cool, I survived. Oh good, another healing item. Take everything! Let me make sure I've got everything all set. Okay. I'll keep the bread until I know for a fact that I cannot heal. Alright. That has been a grueling combat, yet you are less revolted and exhausted by the outcome than would have been so before. You stand astride the body of the Drakkar who led this slain platoon. Beside him is an object that you saw him drop when you struck your killing blow. It is the control handle. You have found the missing part, and you have delivered summary justice. How does that even work? Summary justice? Oh well, that's okay. You have summarily delivered justice, let's change it to that, to the creature that murdered Sheriff Tarler. You place the control handle in your backpack and then you search this spacious building, wary of Geox that may have been taken refuge from the fight and could still be hiding in the shadows. You find no enemies left alive. So damn, those birds really did like murder the heck out of all those people. Anyway. You do discover a bolted trapdoor set into the warehouse floor. It has an iron grill. You peer through the grill and see two villagers huddled together in a workshop below. Quickly, you pull open the draw bolt and lift the trapdoor. Come out, you tell them. The Geox will not harm you now. Just then, a Geox walks through the door, right? Nah. Anyway, the first to climb out is a young man in a leather work apron, followed by a teenage girl. They are villagers, and they count themselves lucky to be alive. They are grateful to you for releasing them, but there is disappointment in their eyes. They fear that you alone will not rid them of the scores of Geox that now occupy their beloved village. Hi, Greg. You missed the increased level Drakkar that I was fighting. I just fought a newer, tougher enemy, which was exciting. You tell them that you are their liege lord. Lone wolf. Because you have to tell everyone, by the way, did you know I'm your liege lord? You can't just be like, my name is Lone Wolf. No, by the way, I am your liege lord. Aw, man. You tell them why you are here and give them a brief account of what you have seen and done since you arrived in Rockstarn. They listen intently to your voice, transfixed by the shocking truth of what you tell them. So, what you've missed. Oh, hey, I've got a little doodad. What is this? Oh, I can put the silver necklace on? Oh, I can only wear one thing at a time. Okay. Well, the silver one's better than the copper one. Okay. So, what you missed so far in Blood in the Snow 2, where we last left off, Leandra was going to go find one of the parts and you had to go find another part or something. Like, there's one part she was going to go get, and there's two, actually, that Lone Wolf has to get. And I followed Leandra going towards the sheriff's office, and then we got attacked by Geox, and so she got separated from you and is somewhere. And meanwhile, you went to the sheriff's office, found the sheriff dead, found a dude that was sentenced to death that was in a cell, and I decided to let him out and let him live, and he gave me a dongle. He gave me a little ring that gives me +2 dexterity, which is cool, and then he ran away. And then from there, I went to the village doctor's office and found a guy who has crushed legs, who was a miner whose legs got all jacked up, and he was just laying there because the Geox had not been in there. And I decided to help him with the medicines that I found in the office. And so I did so, and he went to sleep, and then I ran away and went on to a warehouse where he said there were some people that were supposedly going to help him, you know, if they could only, you know, be let free or whatever. So I just finished the warehouse battle, the one that apparently you died at. And I just let a couple of villagers out from a trapdoor where they were being held. It was locked from the outside, and that's where we're at right now. I've just let them out. And I just told them that I am their liege lord, and then, you know, told them the wonderful tale about what all has happened so far in my time in Rockstar. So, I can decide to stay for a while in order to reassure the villagers, or say, Deuce, peace out, little teenager. I'm gonna reassure them. The news you brought is dire and hard to bear. You feel the refugees' anguish. They are hoping that there is something you will do to ease their suffering. The young man in the leather apron steps forward and says, My name is Darter. I am an apprentice jeweler. My younger brother was chased out of the village when the Geox attacked. He is only 7 years old. He has thick brown hair just like mine. Have you seen him? What is his name? You ask sympathetically. Sarek, says Darter. His name's Sarek. You have neither seen nor heard of this missing boy. The young man can sense this, and you see his face crumple and drop with disappointment. You both know that Geox are unmerciful creatures that rarely take prisoners, especially small and vulnerable ones. You try to console Darter. I will look out for him. Should I find the lad, I will make sure the two of you are reunited. Darter nods his head sadly. He fears he will never see his younger brother again. A tear trickles slowly from his left eye. Is it really significant that it's like his left eye that is teary? Oh well, that's fine. You watch it drop from the edge of his trembling jaw to be swallowed up by the dust of the warehouse floor. The teenage girl is staring at you. She's probably impressed because you're the liege lord. She bites her lower lip and looks like she is desperate to say something but cannot find courage enough to utter a single word. She really wants to say, notice me, senpai. All right, so I can address the hesitant girl or say bye. Okay, no, I don't want to do that. Okay, I almost clicked the button. Okay. Go on, Gwee. Gwee? Her name is Gwee? Okay. Gwee, says her companion, nudging the girl with his elbow. Ask him. The girl mutters her courage to ask you a question. Please, sire, have you been to the sheriff's office? Did you find anyone there? Anyone down in the cells, I mean? Yes, you reply. I have been there, and yes, I found a prisoner in the cells. His name is Marak Jalad. Did you kill him? Gwee's frankness catches you off guard. No, I did not kill him. I set him free. The girl is visibly shocked by your reply. If I had left him locked in this cell, it would only be a matter of time before the Geox found him or he died of thirst. I released him so he would at least have a chance to survive. It may have been a slim chance, but it is better than no chance at all. And that is literally the same text that was at the end of that part where I saved him. Anyway, Gwee's face contorts with anger, and you are shocked by the speed of her sudden transformation. "You set Jalad free," she says, spitting out the man's name with contempt. "You should have killed him. It's only right that he should pay for his life with the pay with his life for the death of my elder brother, Harund. My brother was Reeve to Sheriff Tarler. Jalad and his thieves murdered him in the sunken forest along with another Reeve called Fergo. He must be made to pay for his crime. A life for a life. I am sorry for your loss. I truly am," you reply, trying desperately to soothe her raw emotions. Sadly, her grief is inconsolable. Too many names. Yeah. You feel the weight of duty and responsibility falling heavily on your shoulders. For these young and vulnerable villagers, you are their only hope of salvation. "I give you my word as a Kai Lord, and as the Friar Earl of your province, I will rid your village of these accursed Geoks." Darter raises his head and says, "Sire, is there anything we can do to aid you?" "Yes," you reply, impressed and heartened by Darter's unexpected offer of help. "There is an injured miner at the doctor's surgery. His name is Grove. Go there and collect him, but be careful how you carry him on a stretcher, for his legs have been badly damaged. Bring him back here and await my return. I shall not abandon you." Darter nods assertively in response. "You can count on us, my lord, and if you need to restock your supplies while you are here in village, please come back to us. We can put this warehouse to good use once again and aid you in your fight." "Ha, yes, we have a shopkeeper! Although you could requisition what you need from your subjects by order, you are mindful that they have suffered greatly. Therefore, you accept Darter's proposal. And you insist that you will pay for any supplies you may purchase. Well, yeah. I mean, like, they have no money and their whole town is fucking ruined. I mean, if you've got gold, you might as well fucking give them money. Oh my god. Yes, I want to talk to the merchant. But I am the liege lord. Okay. Alright, that's a lot of crap. Okay, wow. Wow, that's a lot of stuff. Okay. Let me sell some things. Let's sell my old weapon. Okay. Let's sell the copper necklace because it's not so cool. They really play upon heavily the medieval theme about this being a very strong caste system where everybody knows their place in order. That's probably why you're always saying who you are. Yes, yes, I know. That doesn't mean I can't make fun of it. I mean, like, come on. Alright. Oh, I can upgrade shit. Great! My sheld! I can upgrade my sheld. Okay. No, not yet. Let me go ahead and... Ooh, I have a bank! I can put stuff in my bank. That's nice. Alright, well let me put all of these items I don't need in there. I was not this arrogant in the books. Cool. And by I mean Lone Wolf, of course. Lone Wolf is not that arrogant in the books, huh? Okay. Meat soup. What does it do for me? Oh, I need a meat soup. I need to put it in my list of stuff. Oh, and I need some more of these. I need definitely some of those. Alright. Power flare? Oh, stuns enemies. That's cool. That's cool too. Oh, those are expensive as hell. Hmm. I'll get a couple of them. Okay. Let's see. Okay. I need a Kai pouch to upgrade. Alright. Oh no, I don't have enough money. Oh no. Okay. Let me sell my current pouch, my little finest leather pouch. I really don't have enough money for that. Rats! Okay, I gotta sell some more stuff. Yay. Of course I'm still playing it. Playing on normal mode, Greg. How do I move it back? Oh, there we go. I just have to. I was not holding the button long enough. I just want enough money to get that stuff. I will regret if I sell all of these items right away. I sell the ash though. There, now I have enough. Just barely enough, but I have enough. Okay, cool. Yeah, and definitely the music is very fitting. So that's why I really, really enjoy it on this particular game. Alright, so can I like rest? No, I don't want to talk. I want to rest is what I want to do. Damn it. Can I go rest? Yes. Okay. Let us meditate, because I don't want to... I want to be healed before I go fight more... Ah, hell! Ah, well. That's a cool setting. Check that out. You know you're gonna pay for that, right? Now I don't have cooldown enough for it. Gotcha. The big bad way. Yeah. Damn this cooldown. Alright. Almost dead. Almost. Yay! Okay. Oh, not another one! Damn it! And I'm out, fresh out of stuff, and it's still cooling down. Damn it! Fine. I can't hit him at all, apparently. Good job. Alright. That's alright, my stamina's back. You will die. Ooh! Let's kill you. Oh, everything's on cooldown. Not fair. Fine. Fine. Ugh. I'm not able to play this game very well right now. My timing is... Oh, Lord. He's gonna hit me. Aw. Damn it. No! He's gonna kill my ass. I'm not even gonna get any... One is not going to be enough to kill him. I'm going to have to heal. Oh, no, no, no! Oh, damn it. Thanks, Greg. Thanks. I'm going to blame the fact that I died on you because I was doing so well until here. It's not over yet. Restart the battle. I hate how you spent like 2 books to get the damn sword and you can only use it once in a great while. What a ripoff. Yep. Alright. Alright, asshats. That's it. My Kai powers are like way not even allowed right now. Alright. Ah, how are you still alive? Not even fair. There. Okay. That's what I wanted. Got like a tiny bit left. Oh my god. Of course he's gonna get an attack in. That is okay. That is okay. He will die. I'm not worried about it. Asshat. If it wasn't so cheap, I'd try this on the cell. But I hate doing I hate double buying anything. Oh, if you weren't so cheap. Not if this wasn't so cheap. Yeah. This is a lot better on the cell, I want to say. Just because of the control schemes, so... I don't want to go there. I want to rest. Rest! Rest! Damn it! Oh good, it led me this time. I was about to get mad if they didn't actually let me rest this time. Okay, now let me go drop off some supplies that I don't need to be carrying around in here. Cool. 'Cause I sure don't need to carry all that stuff. Alright. And I don't have that much money, so it's not worth me doing much of anything. Like, I could possibly sell some of my upgrade materials and, you know, upgrade something. 2 gold crowns. I think it said 2 gold crowns was an update on one of the items, right? If it's only 2 gold, that's not a big deal. I don't have enough leather. Okay. Knife scabbard. I don't have enough leather because I sold all my leather. My shield. I still need one more iron. Yeah, because I sold all my crap. Never mind, I'll have to come back to that later when I'm not selling all my stuff off. Okay, this is where I need to go. You leave the Bronin warehouse by one of its shattered windows. Your muscles ache from the exertions of combat, yet your thoughts are sharper and your determination is more resolute than ever before. It is early afternoon. With caution in near every step, you follow the street until you catch your first sight of the foundry. This is where Leandra hurriedly disposed of the drive chain while being pursued by Giox. You recall her saying that the foul creature may still occupy this building. As you approach its closed doors, you catch a glimpse of movement. A Giox appears at the ground floor window, its head and shoulders framed by the pane of cracked glass. For a few moments, it peers into the street, and then it moves away, out of your direct view. Leandra was correct. The foundry, like most of Rockstarn, is under enemy occupation. You must gain entry to the foundry and retrieve the drive chain. It will not be an easy task to achieve with Giox roaming freely inside. So, cautiously I approach the foundry and check for unwary targets, or I just spot it and jump through the window. Okay, let us do the cautious thing. The foundry doors are blackened with soot from recent fire. You detect that a group of Giox are gathered inside. One of them presses its ugly face to the cracked glass of a window to the right of the main doors. Its feral eyes stare out into the street, looking for villagers to hunt and slay. You approach the creature from the inside, keeping close to the foundry wall to avoid being seen. When you are close to the window's frame, you wrap the bottom of your cloak around your right fist and punch through the glass with all your might. The pain shatters into hundreds of tiny shards that drive deep into the Giox's face and eyes, leaving it blinded and bloodied. It shrieks with pain as it tumbles to the floor and rolls away, clutching desperately at its ruined face. You seize the initiative and climb through the opening before the injured Giox's comrades fully realize what is happening. Once inside the foundry, you unsheath your weapon and prepare to fight to the death. Yes, yes. It is more beneficial to me to have a friend. Bleed him out. Hog! I keep missing. Okay. There, that's better. That one guy is gonna die anyway from blood loss, so. That guy is gonna get killed pretty soon. And I'ma hide. Yoo-hoo! One down. Get him! Hog! Damn it, I could have dodged if I only played better. Okay, there we go. Actually? Oh my god! Okay. I got one. Okay. Damn you. They both have, like, no life left. I just need them to die. Everything's on cooldown. Yes, I was gonna say, everything's on cooldown. Damn it. Have thoroughly ransacked the foundry, but amongst the overturned workbenches and scattered debris, you find what you came here looking for. Sitting atop a crumpled pile of heavy iron chains, there is one that stands out from the rest. It is smaller, well-oiled, and it has been welded to form a continuous loop. With a sigh of relief, you pick up the drive chain and put it in your backpack. Unfortunately, your discovery is not gone unobserved. The foundry's large double doors swing open, and in a rush, a Drakkar and several armed, snarling Geoks. They were drawn here by the noise of your previous combat, and the Drakkar has been watching you through the cracks in the foundry wall. Sounds like I need to use an item before I can keep going. Alright, where is my life at? I need life and stamina. So, what does this do? That's only Kai power. That doesn't do much good. Life and stamina. Cool. Let's use it. That might help. Alright. He is an imposing armored warrior, human in aspect, but decidedly inhuman in behavior. Now is the moment he has decided to launch the surprise attack. Oh crap, I didn't realize you can use items at any time. Whoops. Yeah, you can use items. So, that's a thing. I don't know if I'm gonna have to top my life off before this fight. I might be, because this Drakkar is gonna be harder. Okay. Fuck you! Ugh! You ass. Oh lord, with all these guys. Okay, let's use a summer sword. At least chop his life in half. Okay, and I don't have enough magic for that. Go ahead and heal. And then... Ah, oh, he dodged! No! Ah, fuck you. Actually... almost dead. Cool. Ah, fuck. Okay, one down. Cool. My Kai power is back. Let's summon my buddy. Now. Oh, hell. Come on, you can do it. Yes! Alright. Okay. I can do this. I got it. Get him! Yes, and that is why I like the wolf. Alright. The Mortal Kombat style finishers are really awesome. Yup. Whoop whoop! I did it! I had to use a healing potion, but that's okay. Take everything, always. You leave the foundry feeling exhausted by the strain of combat, yet exhilarated for having found the drive chain. Yeah. How about I heal? I will heal. Yes, they actually let me heal. I'm all like, I always wait and I'm just intensely watching the little image of Lone Wolf sitting there meditating to see if it's just gonna part because that means that I'm SOL. Alright, let me go back to the warehouse. Cool. Yes, I want to talk to the merchant. Oh, I can rest here too. That's cool. Not that I'm gonna do that because I already did that. Alright, so, Pine. A hackar! That entertains me. A hackar. Okay. Throwing knives, tunnel sweepers. I will be selling the hackar. Nope, nope, nope. Alright. I don't have anything else. Okay, cool. Different levels of copper necklaces. I didn't even realize. Okay. Intelligence and so on. I guess the intelligence is for the Kai powers. What does copper ring do? Oh, intelligence. Strength. Or dexterity, probably. Yeah. I think I have an open spot. I can do the intelligence one to up my awesome factor. Alright. Then, let me see if I have enough stuff to upgrade anything. Yes, I do! I can upgrade shield! That would be good. Alright, cool. What else we got? I don't have enough iron. Hell. Leather. Don't have enough steel. I don't have enough anything. Oh, you weren't aware you could do that either. Yeah, okay. Let me see what I actually need. Okay, oh, let me buy another one of these. Oh, I have four. I should be okay for now. Let me buy another meat soup, though. Because I totally will use that. Okay, so let me look at my upgrades and see if how much anything costs. Okay, for knives, all I need is one leather. How about my weapon? Oh, that's too much crap I need. That is too much crap I need. Two superior leather. It looks like two regular leather to upgrade my knives. or one regular leather, that's all I need. Okay. That sounds good. Street and make your way with caution among the fire-blackened ruins of homes and workshops in this part of Rockstarn. Now you possess the missing parts needed to fix the elevator and reach the sunken forest. Leandra is likely to be waiting for you at the boiler house, and you do not want to keep her waiting a minute longer than necessary. You quicken your pace and head toward the end of the village to where the buildings come to an abrupt halt at the edge of the cliff. And that is the end of that chapter. I think that is a good place to stop. So thank you for watching. Thank you for listening along. And next time, I will go ahead and continue on with Blood on the Snow 3. But for today, that is all. Enjoy your evening. Take care.